So our program, we have an exciting open house scheduled for today. I'm going to talk a little bit about the program, and then you'll hear from my dear colleagues, who I'm going to briefly introduce. That's Dr. Marcy Height, Dr. Shannon Bramlett, Dr. Mark Fagelson, and then you already heard from Dr. Jacek Smysinski, who serves as the director. Briefly about myself, I've been with ETSU since 2005. I finished my PhD at East Carolina University, so it wasn't much of a transition from a pirate to a buccaneer over here. I hold the ranking of a professor, and I teach a few courses. I teach an auditory electrophysiology course, the second in that sequence. I also teach auditory processing disorders. And this year I've started teaching about cochlear implants. And those are my research and clinical interest also. My research interest is in auditory processing, where I use both behavioral and physiological measures to understand how auditory processing mechanisms are affected positively by like conditions like musical training. And we are also looking at the challenges individuals that might have who suffer from diabetes or from concussion. So I have a few students working on capstones projects on that. And then in clinics also, I bring my interests and my experiences to the clinics. I run a clinic at our own Nave Center that you'll be hearing a lot more today. I've seen children with auditory processing disorders. I do electrophysiological assessments. I also work with adults, mainly with cochlear implants. So the plan is for us, as Dr. Smysinski was mentioning, you're going to hear different facets of our program from my dear colleagues. And towards the end, you'll also hear from some of our students about they're excited to share about their exciting things that they do with the Student Academy of Audiology. We are going to have a question and answer session towards the end, but feel free to ask your questions in the chat. We are monitoring that, and we'll answer them as we get your questions. And as Dr. Smysinski was mentioning it, towards the end, you'll have an opportunity to discuss candidly with our students to learn their perspective as they are in different parts of their program. From its inception, audiology has focused on the measurement of hearing and the impact of hearing loss on communication and social function. And its origins, you probably would have heard, is from the veterans returning back from the World War II. That's when the rehabilitation program started establishing, and then as the need increased, there were academic programs emerging. As such, audiology is a helping profession. And I'm sure I'm preaching to the choir. So if you're finding yourself on a Saturday morning in an open house for a clinical doctorate program, I'm sure you're probably a little bit interested in the clinical aspects of audiology. As an audiologist, you'll be working with individuals who have hearing, balance, tinnitus, or other sensory issues, related sensory issues. And as an audiologist, you'll be seeing patients as young as a few days. If you're involved in a newborn hearing screening program, and of course, you probably some of you would have had a personal experience of somebody elderly in your home suffering with a hearing loss with wearing a hearing aid or a cochlear implant. So it is definitely a helping profession, and that's what drives us and motivates us to do what we are. And while you're doing it as a profession, you don't have a shabby living, you do have a decent life. The median pay, as it's shown over here, is about more than 77,000. And we do pretty decently if you were working hourly also. And when you're looking at the surveys and you're looking at the population of audiologists working, initially it used to be all ENT clinics, But now you're seeing the largest growing sectors are actually private audiologists, private clinics. And you see the entrepreneurship in our audiologists starting their own private clinic and establishing their independence. And the outlook for audiology as a profession and most allied health professions is very positive. There's a growing demand with the growing aging population and increasing awareness, and how even minimal hearing losses are what used to be considered non-significant amounts of hearing losses affecting social life. And because of advocacy efforts, people are getting more aware about that and pursuing audiological assessments and rehabilitation if the need be. So we expect it to grow in the years. And interestingly, in one of the studies, one of the capstone projects our students are pursuing, they're looking at how audiology clinics adapted with the recent the pandemic, the COVID affecting us. It was interesting to see, like any other profession, audiology was affected, but how quickly the audiologist the clinics resumed offering and helping the community for their needs. So it showed like even though it was affected by April, by May, June, most audiology clinics started reaching back to their patients and resuming especially services to them. So it kind of shows a resilience of the field and towards even this traumatic influence that affected the pandemic that affected all ways of life. Our audiology program has had a long history, and you probably would have seen from the get-go how our program is intertwined with the VA audiology program at the Mountain Home, which is just across the city. Geographically, it's just across the street from where ETSU is located. In fact, the VA program, you're going to be hearing a lot more about it from Dr. Mark Fagelson down the road today. But many of our ETSU programs, the College of Medicine, the College of Pharmacy, our even PT program within our college is located at the VA campus. We have had a master's in audiology program since the 70s, but we transitioned into the doctorate of audiology in the 1999. It wasn't until the 90s when ASHA, the American Speech Language Hearing Association, recognized considering the depth and the widening scope of practice of audiology, that a master's degree was not be sufficient to train these well-qualified professionals to deal with all the wide array of patients we see. We are proud that our program at ETSU was one of the earlier programs to start. We admitted the first AUD class in 2003, a couple of years before I joined. Which was actually many of the master's program transitioned into this clinical doctorate program, and we graduated our first cohort in 2005. Our program is accredited by the Council on Academic Accreditation, which is a division of the American Speech Language and Hearing Association. Recently in 2019, in October, we actually had our accreditation site visit, which went very positively. And now we are accredited for the next 8 years, up to 2028. So as such, our program is designed, carefully designed to offer an intensive academic curriculum together, along with an integrated sequential clinical experience. And that's something that you'll see in our program, and you'll hear from our students, is how we try to immerse you in our clinical experience and hand in hand along with the didactic courses that you're going to be taking in. Our students are enrolled for 11 semesters of full time. And you'll find out that our whole curriculum is about 120 credit hours. And we have a very prescribed sequence of courses. Among 77 of those credit hours are for didactic courses, and we have 45 semester hours of clinical courses. Okay, and we've been proud that since our inception, 100% of our graduates have passed the national practice examination, and 100% immediately have found employment after that. Some even while they are in their fourth year, and many of them actually join where they go for their fourth year, which we're kind of feeling mixed about, because we initially our thoughts were that that might preclude that particular site taking another one of our students for a fourth-year externship. But now we find out that actually many of the sites are taking again students from us. So we have like a second or third generation students doing fourth-year externships in a few of our clinical sites all around the country, I should say that. And you'll see a graph that Dr. Heitel's going to be talking about where we have fourth-year placements in more than 20 states around the country, and even two in Hawaii and in Alaska. Interesting, the student that went to Hawaii was from Maine, and that one from Alaska was from the South, which we found very interesting. And we've got one other student who just is returning back from a fourth-year externship interview in Wyoming, which is in a state that we haven't had a student before, so we're excited to hear where if she's going to be joining that clinic. So we've got a detailed plan of study, program of study on our website that I encourage you guys to visit and learn more about the sequencing of our courses. But essentially, we start off with the foundation courses in the first year, in the first semester. So that would be foundation courses in instrumentation, in anatomy, physiology. You'll have your first of your basic audiological evaluation course, and you'll also have a neurology course. In the first semester itself, we have you at least in one half day of clinic, along with, in addition to the lab course that Dr. Bramlett is presently teaching. So we'll be hands-on implementing some of the concepts that you're learning already in class. And progressively, as you progress, you will have more advanced courses, and your clinical load is going to be proportionally being increasing, culminating in your fourth year, which would be a full-time clinical externship. So some of the strengths of our program, and you're going to be hearing that throughout this morning, is a large and diverse faculty that we have. All of our faculty have their own independent areas of clinical and research interests that they teach in, and they also supervise our students in the clinics in those areas. And many of them work on capstone projects with our students, so also improving that research experiences with our students also. You'll hear from Dr. Smizinski. I don't know, many of you guys would be very eager to hear about that. We've been very fortunate to find a lot of funding opportunities for our students, some from at the level of the university, some from the college, and some from the department. Our students also have been very good in procuring assistantships, graduate assistantships, teaching assistantships with other programs around, very successful in finding GAs at the testing center, at the computer lab, at the disability center, where we're kind of repeat customers in a way. We have always have students, and it's because of how professional, mature our students are, this kind of a tradition of our students getting continuing to have GA opportunities in those places. You're going to find out that we have a wide range of clinical opportunities. As I said, each of us have our own independent clinics that we supervise students in, and also we strategically, and Dr. Heitel is going to explain how strategically we place you in offsite clinics so you have a well-balanced clinical experiences with VA experiences, with ENT, private practice, and in our own university clinics. And you'll also hear from Dr. Smirzinski about the research opportunities. As a program, you are expected to complete a capstone research experience, which has taken different forms. And you'll find out that how many of the students are working with each other faculty on their areas of interest. You'll also hear from Dr. Hyatt about the interprofessional education, and that's in lines with the overall medical home model that we'll see throughout the health profession, and how ETSU in general and our program has been very involved in providing this IPE experiences, interprofessional education experiences, interdisciplinary experiences for us, not only in the theory, but also in our clinical rotations. You'll find that our program has those unique courses. You'll find out that you'll hear from Dr. Mark Fagelson about this tinnitus course that was just unique, and not many programs offer an independent courses in tinnitus. You'll find out about this vestibular courses, the two sequence vestibular courses that's taught by Dr. Faith Aiken, which is nationally known for her expertise in vestibular sciences. And we'll hear all the programs, all the courses that we're teaching are by faculty who are very involved in that area, particular area that you're teaching. Dr. Fagelson, if you haven't, you probably would have recognized his name from his TED talk that recently. I meant to check the number of visits on YouTube today, but we are cheering for him to get those million views.
So for his TED talk. Let me jump in there. So it actually did go past a million this morning, just this morning.
Fantastic. I really meant to look that up this morning about that, but yeah. Kudos. We gotta celebrate that.
Yeah, it's great because I know absolutely nothing about social anything. Forget social media. Social anything. So the YouTube thing is close, but I just found out this morning. So very excited.
Fantastic. Congratulations for that. Again. Another week celebration. Out. And another unique strength of our program is of the relatively small size that we take our students in. We want to provide this intense clinical experience and closely monitor the progress of our students. And we are very cognizant about that when we choose our class size. So now we have about 12 PhD faculty in our program. So five of us from ETSU, the main core, and then we have got the rest from the VA faculty. The VA faculty are not considered adjunct faculty. They have full-time geographical appointment with us because their role is not only teaching the particular course that they teach, they also work with our students in the clinics and work in research projects. They're involved in those comprehensive exams that Dr. Smizinski is going to be talking about. They're involved again in the admission process and pretty much all aspects of the program. So here's a list of the faculty, and you'll be hearing again a few of them, and we have a few video recordings of the VA faculty who could not join us this morning. Dr. Bess Sermon Taylor is our chair. She joins us from a program in Texas. She's recently joined us. And we're excited to have her. In fact, she is going to be teaching the counseling course, which one of the courses that you'll be taking in the second year summer. And I think I've mentioned a few of these names, but if you visit our website, you'll get more information of those that you will not be able to hear. We didn't have a chance to hear from them today. Okay, again, we're excited to have you guys over here today. I'm gonna hand over to Dr. Height, who's gonna talk about our clinical education aspect of our program. Dr. Height?
Yes, thank you. Is it okay if I just start by introducing myself a little bit more? Okay.
Yes, please. Yes.
So my name is Marcia Height, and I have been faculty here at ETSU since 2017. I got my AUD and my PhD both from the Texas Tech University Health Sciences Center. So I'm originally from Texas, but I consider Tennessee home now. My family's up here, so it's definitely where I would rather be than dry, dusty Lubbock. So I'm very happy to be here. My classes that I teach are for the first year's instrumentation. So that's first year, first semester. We talk a lot about audiometers and calibration and different sort of basics of what instruments we use in the clinic. I also teach the pediatric courses. So in the second year, there is a diagnostic pediatric course. And then in the second year spring, there is a rehab pediatric course that I teach both of those. And so my clinics are also primarily pediatric. I've been fortunate to get a lot of ABRs. So infants who do not pass their newborn hearing screening will come and see me at our Nave clinic for a diagnostic ABR test. So primarily that's been my clinic load lately. I also see older kids and adults, and I do hearing aids as well. So that's primarily what my clinic will consist of. Then research-wise, my dissertation was in listening effort, so I actually have an eye tracker that I use to measure changes in pupil dilation to infer cognitive load. So that's been my dissertation and sort of my area of research interest. But also lately, I've been involved in several student capstone projects that have kind of diversified my research interests a little bit. Two that I'm just excited about that I want to share really quickly. There is a neonatal abstinence syndrome work group here at ETSU. So it's audiologists, speech language pathologists, physicians, nurses, PT. It's this very diverse group of professionals all working together to study this database of infants who are born with NAS. That's sort of a hot topic in this area of the country. So we specifically have been looking at the hearing screening data for these babies. So that's been an exciting study that there's not a lot of literature out there on NAS babies. So that's been a fun project. Also, I'm doing a parent self-efficacy workshop. So parents who have children with hearing impairment and working with them and having the confidence to troubleshoot hearing aids and different things like that. So those have both been really fun new projects that I've been working on with students. Also, one of the things that I do here at ETSU is I am the audiology representative for our IPE, our interprofessional education. So this is across the entire ETSU health programs. So the med school, the nursing school, pharmacy school, our College of Clinical and Rehabilitative Health Sciences. So we have PT in all of these different groups, speech, nutrition. We, all the students in these graduate programs come together in interdisciplinary teams and work together through different team building exercises, communication exercises. We even have standardized patient activities. So if you don't know what a standardized patient is, it's essentially a highly trained actor who comes in with a script of a patient and tells you their symptoms and what sort of problems they're having. And you, as the clinical team, are going to go in and kind of do a telehealth sort of a session with them. Because of COVID, a lot of this has turned from in-person meetings to Zoom meetings. So we've been playing it like, oh, this is a telehealth session now. So we'll be talking to our standardized patient over Zoom and counseling and discussing different options with them. Overall, I strongly encourage all of our students to be involved with IPE. I think it's very important as a way for us to advocate for audiology. Many of these students in these other professions may not know what an audiologist is or how we contribute to the healthcare team. So this is a fantastic opportunity for you as students to learn how to advocate and to educate these other future professionals about how important audiology is in this interprofessional healthcare team. So that if you have questions about that, please let me know. It's something that I've been involved in for a couple of years and I really love. Another big thing that I do here at ETSU is I am the clinical education coordinator. So what that means is I'm the person who goes in and schedules where our students are going to be having their clinic every semester. So, and Dr. Ellen Govan kind of hinted at this a little bit, but it's kind of like Tetris, figuring out, okay, this student has not had an ENT placement, so I want to try to be sure to put them in an ENT placement next semester. My goal as a clinical education coordinator is that every student who graduates from our program has a well-rounded clinical experience. I want to be sure that everybody has an ENT placement, everybody has a vestibular placement, everybody has a tinnitus placement, everybody has a pediatric placement. So even if you come in knowing, I don't want to do peds, I'm still going to make you go to a pediatric clinic because my goal is to make you well-rounded. With that being said, though, by the time you get into your third year, if there's a little flexibility in the schedule. So if you have been to an ENT and a VISTIB and all of these other ones, but you really like something and you would like extra clinic in something, I try to make that work. I take student preference into account. But again, my main goal is that everybody gets a well-rounded experience. So to kind of return to this PowerPoint here, this is sort of an outline of how much clinic students are going to have each year in our program. So in year one, you may only have 1 to 1.5 days of clinic per week. But then you see, as you get further and further into the program, I try to get you more and more clinical opportunities. In the second year, 2 to 3 days of clinic. In the third year, 3 to 3.5. So your fourth year is typically not with us. You go out into the world on your fourth year, wherever you're applying for these positions. And this is going to be a full-time clinical experience. So you're working a 40 hours a week sort of job in a clinic somewhere. So my role in all of this for years 1, 2, and 3, I'm assigning you to these different clinics. And then in year 4, I'm the liaison between you and all these programs that you're applying to. I initiate that contact with those potential fourth year placements. I set up any paperwork if you are offered an accepted position. So we will work very closely in your third year trying to find you a fourth year placement. And so let's go to the next slide here. Yes, thank you. I have a list of on-campus clinical opportunities. So in year one, especially, we like to keep our students close to home. So in your first year, you're going to be in our ETSU audiology clinics in Lamb Hall or at the Nave Center in Elizabethton. So you'll hear more about both of these clinics, but for me, I just wanted to point out in your first year, this is probably the only place you're going to be put. We want to keep a close eye on you as you're developing these fundamental clinical skills. In the second year, we start sending students to the VA, the Mountain Home VA. So we still consider it on campus because we work very closely with the VA. We have them on our faculty. We talk with them on a monthly basis. We have meetings with them. So it's considered another on-campus location here. You won't go there, though, until your second year. And they have a very diverse clinical opportunity for students. And they're also very strategic, similar to me, that they're enrolling students in these different clinics to make sure you get a diverse range of experiences. Everybody's going to have a hearing aid clinic. Everybody's going to have a neuro ABR clinic. They're very strategic about how they schedule. For off-campus clinical opportunities, the next slide, I believe, has a full list, but just to give you some general categories here, we have several private practices that we work with, several ENT offices that we work with, speech and hearing centers. We even have a placement with the public school system, hospital settings. There are other VA hospitals. So if we want to go to this next slide here, these are some specific clinics, just to give you an idea of some opportunities that we have. And again, you might go to these in your second year, but definitely by your third year. By the third year, I'm pushing students out of the Tri-Cities, out of Johnson City, into these off-campus placements. So MetaView, ENT, Mountain Region Speech and Hearing. Some of these, just to give you a heads up, are quite a drive away from Johnson City. Like Asheville, we have an ENT placement in Asheville that is amazing. We have another VA hospital in Asheville that is also amazing. The Buncombe County Schools is in Asheville. So that's 1.5 hour drive from Johnson City. So just to give you a heads up, in the first year and the second year, you probably are not going to have to travel very far. But in the third year, I have to push third year students out so that the first and second year students can take those in-town placements. So by third year, you may have to do a little bit of travel to get to your clinical placement. And also, just so you know, I am aggressively trying to get more clinical placements for students. So there's a couple not on this list that I'm hoping to add in the summer of next year. There's a lot of a lot of paperwork and different things that have to get settled before we can add a new placement to these lists. So just so you know, though, I'm always looking for new opportunities for students. Okay. So we talked about this one a little bit. This is a really neat map just to show you where have we sent students for their fourth years in the past. So Dr. Ellen Govan mentioned the one in Alaska and the one in Hawaii. That was before my time, so I didn't get to know those students personally. But you will see there's a little bit of a pattern of a lot of students choose to stay in this sort of area, but it's open to anywhere that you want to be. I've even had some students looking internationally, like at Canada or another placement like that. But typically our students stay in the United States here. So, and I believe the next 8 or so slides are just going to be a list of places where we've sent students. I will pause here to say we have a very strong history of sending students to VA placements. Because of our relationship here with the Mountain Home VA, our students are very attractive to fourth year VA positions because they have that VA experience. So we have a very strong history of sending students there. But as you go through this list and see, we also send students to pediatric placements. We send them to vestibular placements. They're placements all over the country that we have sent our students in, have been very successful in a wide range of practices. So Cleveland Clinic is one that we're also very proud of. That if you haven't heard of the Cleveland Clinic, it's a very prestigious sort of fourth year placement. So it was very exciting when our student got accepted for that position there. Yeah, Pediatric ENT of Atlanta. So typically when you are in the process in your third year and you're in the process of applying for fourth years, often how that works is a student sends me a list of where they're interested in going and I help them kind of make that contact and they interview. It's much like getting a job, much like applying for grad school, really. You have to send in all your documents and have an interview, and if you are offered the position, you can accept. But where the student goes for their fourth year is primarily driven by the student. They decide where they want to apply. We have this list just to give you an idea of where people have gone before, but really it's up to you. Where do you want to go? And what opportunities are you interested in? My advice is always to go well-rounded. Even if you know you love peds and you only want to do peds, well, how about you go to a hospital setting that does pediatric and adults, just so you can have that well-rounded experience in your fourth year. But ultimately, it's up to you as the student to decide where you want to go.
Can I jump in here super quick, Dr. Hyde? I think I speak for everyone when I say aim high with that fourth year. You're only going to do it one time. And so keep in mind, it can help set you up for your next move as well, right? So we always encourage students to aim high for that. You also have to go someplace where there are ASHA certified preceptors. So as much as you would like to live on the beach and work at Frank's hearing aid hut in Nag's Head, that probably wouldn't work out because you wouldn't get a well-rounded experience, but also there might not be an ASHA certified preceptor at that site. So it's sure the students come to Dr. Height with some choices of where they'd like to go. And then I think it's a fairly collaborative process to try to get people to a spot where they're going to do well and get a lot out of it.
Do you mind if I hop in just very briefly? I am a third year student, and I will be talking to you a little bit later about the Student Academy of Audiology. I am currently going through the process of applying to fourth year, so I can answer any questions that you may have about the student side of things a little bit later, so.
Wonderful, thank you both for the comments. So I think as far as clinical kind of education, that wraps it up for my portion of this presentation, but please let me know if you have any questions related to that. I'll be happy to address that.
Hello, I think this is my part. My name is Shannon Bramlett, and I'm the clinical faculty member here that works on site at ETSU. I can tell you a little bit about my history here at ETSU. Prior to working at ETSU, I worked at a nonprofit speech and hearing center for many years. I was also the executive director of that clinic for 6 years. So I got a lot of variety of experiences in management and writing grants and humanitarian kind of efforts while also being an audiologist as well. I joined ETSU in 2014, and I've been in a variety of roles here at ETSU. I've been in the clinic. I've worked on building programs within the ETSU clinic, such as the pediatric program and the cochlear implant program. I've done clinic coordination for students. I've worked adjunct. I've worked part-time. And in 2019, I came back to ETSU in a full-time role. My favorite place to be, obviously, is in the clinic. I love seeing patients and working with students and patients. So that's where my office is located. At the picture you can see here on the slide, I'm at the Center for Audiology and Speech-Language Pathology, which is located at the Nave Center. I also teach a first-year clinic lab class, and so right when you enter the program, we immediately start learning clinical skills like looking in ears, how to use the audiometers, how to use all of the equipment, and it's a really fun class, and it really lets you get in there immediately and be able to feel comfortable seeing patients, because one thing that's pretty unique about our program as that students start in the clinic immediately. So pretty much your first week that you're here at ETSU, you will be seeing patients in some capacity. I also serve on a variety of capstone projects. So that's sort of my role here at ETSU. As far as my clinical interests, my strong clinical interest is pediatrics and cochlear implants. I also work with osseointegrated devices such as Bajas and Pontos. Electrophysiologic testing. I'm trying to hit all the ones. I also see adults. Pretty much whoever comes into the clinic, I'm pretty comfortable working with and seeing. I would like to mention that something that's important to many of us here is humanitarian audiology. Many of our capstone projects will be in that area, and we do many things here at ETSU in order to kind of be good community members with our program. We have a sliding fee scale, which allows patients to come into the clinic and be able to have access to hearing healthcare and or hearing aids if they need those. One of our major humanitarian projects is just coming up here in November. It's called the Remote Area Medical Project, and our students are exclusively involved in that. I personally have participated in that for about 15, 16 years. It's a really unique thing. Basically, we go to the fairgrounds here in our community, and there's a variety of healthcare services that are provided to underserved patients or patients that need a variety of healthcare. So we're pretty fortunate that we've been able to provide hearing evaluations as well as hearing aids to patients that come to that humanitarian endeavor. So that's always a really great thing to be involved in. As far as the Center for Audiology and Speech Pathology, here are listed some things that you might be involved in through your clinical endeavors at our clinic. Our clinic is multidisciplinary in some ways. We're adding more specialties over to the Nave clinic, but our whole entire speech language pathology clinic is now located there, which is a pretty unique and awesome thing that we're able to collaborate with our colleagues in the speech language pathology program. We do have a listening and spoken language or auditory verbal therapist, which is unique and a wonderful thing as far as our cochlear implant program and our pediatric patients that are identified with hearing loss. We work together with her to make sure that patients, pediatrics, children are able to make progress as far as their spoken language acquisition. We perform adult and pediatric ADRs, adult diagnostics, hearing conservation. Dr. Fagelson might speak to you a little bit, but he does some hearing conservation with some of the people who need to have their hearing tested if they work in a loud environment. A lot of them are ETSU employees, hearing aids, the Adult Tinnitus Assessment and Rehabilitation and Hyperacusis Program, which is unique to our program. And Dr. Fagelson probably will talk to you a little bit about how that works. We participate in a lot of community health fairs, although it's been a little bit strange this year. We've not been able to do as many of those things, but we really pride ourselves in being part of the community. As far as our cochlear implant program, we're pretty proud of it. It's a variety of adults and children. We do candidacy evaluations as well as mapping and working with patients as they go through that process. We currently have about 240 patients that come to our clinic for cochlear implant care. I think I've got everything covered. Did I leave anything out here? We have most of these things listed. We did want, because you're not able to be here today and see our facility and see our clinic, we're going to go ahead and show you a video. And I would really like to thank the clinic GAs. I'm really fortunate that I get to work with them a lot in the clinic. And they worked really hard to prepare this video for you so you could kind of get a taste of what the clinic looks like, what type of equipment we have, and all of those sorts of things. So I think Dr. Smirsinski is going to play that for you.
The ETSU Audiology Clinic is a part of the Center for Audiology and Speech-Language Pathology and operated primarily from the ETSU Nave Health Clinic. The ETSU Center for Audiology and Speech-Language Pathology is a university-based, nonprofit clinic with a primary mission to provide highest quality, evidence-based speech-language learning and hearing health care to the community. We support this mission by providing outstanding direct health care to individuals in our community, training future clinic professionals, participating in clinical and translational research, and providing healthcare-based educational opportunities for related professionals of other organizations in our region. This clinic is located off campus in Elizabethton, Tennessee, which is a short drive from the ETSU main campus. In our ETSU Audiology Clinic, we have two state-of-the-art audiology suites where we provide a comprehensive range of expert hearing care and services to patients of all ages in our region. Main services include hearing aid fittings for adults and pediatrics, pediatric testing including visual reinforcement audiometry and auditory brainstem response testing, central auditory processing testing, cochlear implant mapping with all three manufacturers, as well as interdisciplinary clinics with speech-language pathologists encompassing auditory verbal therapy as well as an autism clinic.
This is Audiology Suite 1. This room is primarily used for pediatric hearing evaluations, cochlear implant mapping, central auditory processing evaluations, and auditory brainstem response testing. This room is also equipped for hearing aid repair as well as video otoscopy. Audiology Suite 1 utilizes the Madsen Astera 2 computer-based audiometer. The Astera 2 allows for either computer shortcuts or a traditional audiometer remote control to a complete hearing evaluation. Suite 1 also utilizes the Madsen Zodiac tympanometer as well as the Madsen Oracle FreeFit hearing aid verification system. All of these connect to OtoSuite for an integrated experience from hearing evaluation to hearing aid fitting. OtoSuite also integrates the video otoscopy system for a more interactive experience for our patients. This is Audiology Suite 2. This room is primarily used for adult hearing aid evaluations, hearing aid fittings, hearing aid repair, and cerumen management. AudioSuite 2 utilizes the Grayson Stadler AudioStar Pro audiometer. Having experience with two different manufacturers of audiologic testing equipment allows our students to be more comfortable and confident at fourth-year externship placements as well as in the workforce. AudioSuite 2 utilizes the AudioScan VeriFit 2 hearing aid verification system. Hearing aid verification is an essential part of evidence-based hearing aid fittings and allows us to be confident that our patients are appropriately amplified. AudioSuite 2, we have an irrigator lavage wax management system. For patients with impacted cerumen, the irrigator gives clinicians a quick and easy solution to clear the ears for more accurate testing.
At the Nave, both suites are equipped with sound field speakers for pediatric, hearing aid, and cochlear implant testing. Both suites are also equipped with visual reinforcement audiometry technology. Suite number 1 contains video VRA,
as well as an ABR or auditory brainstem response testing system. ABR testing is used for infants and children who are unable to perform behavioral testing. Suite number one also includes a touchscreen assistant monitor inside the booth to enhance clinical training experiences.
The Nave Center is also equipped to see patients who have received cochlear implants. Students will get training under Dr. Ellen Govan and Dr. Bramlett, and we work with all three cochlear implant manufacturers, Cochlear Americas, Advanced Bionics, and MedEl.
We also provide an opportunity for our patients to enroll in a flex trial. This unique opportunity allows our patients to experience and try hearing aids from some of the major hearing aid manufacturers before making a decision about purchasing.
Here at East Tennessee State University, we encourage our students to apply to fourth-year positions all across the country. Our goal is to graduate confident and well-rounded clinicians who are focused on making a difference in their communities. Go Bucks!
Hey, I'm Mark Fagelson. I've been at ETSU since probably around the time many of you were being born. That would be mid-late 90s. I got my PhD from the University of Texas at Austin. I went to school back in the day when you had to get a master's degree also. I got that at Columbia in New York City. I've worked in and out of VA hospitals for a lot of the time since then, and actually including that time in school too. I teach the AuditVal 1 class for the first years, then a pathologies class for the first years. I split the AuditVal 2 class with Dr. Smrzynski over the summer of your first year, medical audiology in the second year, and then the tinnitus management class in the third year. I've been seeing tinnitus patients regularly at the Mountain Home VA and off and on at ETSU since 2001. We've got more than 1,000 patients enrolled in the clinic at the VA, and I've been fortunate enough to be able to talk about that patient population and write about it a bit over the years. So in terms of the VA at Mountain Home, I would say it's probably one of the best top two or three VA audiology sections in the country. The audiologists there are very active, not just in the clinic. They also are, many of them are very effective researchers, grant writers, and we're very fortunate that they teach a bunch of classes for us as well and supervise in the clinic. So these are some of the areas in which students can get some experience while working at the VA. You can advance the slide unless I can. Can I? Probably the one of the things that, this has been mentioned already, but just for more detail, one of the things that really sets our program apart from many others is that we have a in-house two-semester sequence in vestibular science. So with one of the most respected vestibular audiologists in the world, Faith Aiken. And so you see different kinds of tests listed there. And of course, she provides instruction in all those tests, not just conducting them, but also interpreting the results, and even arguably more important, understanding all the physiology and anatomy underneath all those tests, because it's pretty complicated. So I would say that I'm a good example of somebody who is basically an astute clinician and then writes about it. I don't consider myself much of a researcher or a scientist, frankly, but one of the things that I've learned over the years is that by keeping one's eyes and ears open in the clinic, really listening to patients, really engaging them, and in the tinnitus and sound intolerance area, that's arguably more important than in a few other areas. But by doing that, you really learn a lot from the patients. And working with patients who have bothersome tinnitus or sound tolerance problems is very humbling because there's no cure for these problems for the most part. There are ways to manage the problems, and different people require different sort of intervention strategies. And the beauty of that is that it really never gets too boring because you always have to do a lot of sort of different things with different people, depending on what it is they've told you is a challenge to them. I've tried to weave that sort of that logic and that philosophy into the courses I teach. So although we cover sometimes some physics and math and stuff that you might not really have bargained for when you decided you wanted to do audiology, it's all important. And it's, to me, because for me, teaching is my favorite thing. It's really important to be able to weave those ideas into the clinical work that you're ultimately going to be doing. Let's not forget, wherever you end up going, you're all signing on for a clinical doctorate, and you're doing it because you want to make a difference in people's lives. So it's our job to make sure that you understand the value of the math and the physics and the anatomy and the physiology, because that's what's going to separate you, I think, in my experience anyway, that's what can separate you from a lot of other people who are seeking the same sort of jobs that you are. And I think if you speak to students in their fourth year or students fresh out into the workplace, what many of them will say is that having a job was so much easier than being in school. And that's what we want. We want our graduates to get out into the world and actually have an easier time out there than they had here, because that'll mean we did our job preparing the student for that eventuality. So I guess I'll leave it there. I've got a couple projects that I've been working on. I'm working with a couple of very good groups of people on really two things right now. One is an internet cognitive behavioral therapy program for patients with bothersome tinnitus. It was piloted many years ago in Sweden. The group I'm working with just also did a nice large study using it in the UK. And so I helped them sort of prepare to do that in the US as well. So that's ongoing. And then I'm working on a hearing aid project with a colleague who is at Duke, Sherry Smith. She used to be at the VA across the street. And we're looking at hearing aid, really attack times on compression for hearing aids for patients with post-traumatic stress disorder. So we developed a questionnaire that a few students have used for their capstone experience to assess some of the more unusual reports from patients who have post-traumatic stress disorder in the VA system regarding their hearing aid fittings. So that's yet another group of patients that I do a lot of work with, because it turns out that at least at our VA, about a third of the patients with bothersome tinnitus also have post-traumatic stress disorder. So we see a lot of unusual things in that clinic, and it's great. And we just hope that sort of the environment gets more conducive to people actually going to clinics, so that we, kind of get our patient load back up again at the VA. In the meantime, I'm also doing a video counseling with veterans. I've only done one of those sessions, but hopefully more of them will appear on the schedule soon.
The East Tennessee State University Doctor of Audiology program is a collaboration between the ETSU College of Rehabilitative Sciences Department of Audiology and the James H. Quillen Veterans Affairs Medical Center Department of Audiology. The collaboration between facilities provides extensive educational and clinical opportunities for our doctoral students. The ETSU VA faculty consists of 9 PhD level, 15 AUD level, 1 master's level audiologist, and several adjunct professors. In addition to the vast clinical possibilities, the curriculum offered in our program prepares students for the educational demands in all areas of audiology. James H. Quillen Healthcare System and the Mountain Home VA Healthcare System are located adjacent to the ETSU main campus and within the community of Johnson City. The 247-acre campus boasts a park-like setting and contains many historical buildings and the National Cemetery. Since 1903, James H. Quillen VA Medical Center has been improving the health of men and women who have so proudly served our nation. Services are available to more than 170,000 veterans living in a 41-county area of Tennessee, Virginia, and Kentucky. 31 of the 54 buildings are historic landmarks. The Department of Audiology is on the ground floor of Building 209. The entrance to building 209 is also the main entrance to the emergency room and is currently the only entrance in use. The VA faculty has 13 full-time audiologists, 2 part-time audiologists, and 3 health technicians. In 2019, they issued 4,220 hearing aids. Due to COVID-19, everyone entering our facilities is screened and visitors are limited. Face coverings are mandatory and social distancing is practiced. The facilities at the VA are state-of-the-art in order to serve our nation's veterans. The VA Audiology Department has 13 sound suites and booths, 7 programmable hearing aid stations, 2 evoked potential systems, 2 VNG systems, 2 rotary chairs, and 2 posturography units. The VA also has a teleaudiology suite. Currently, only tinnitus counseling is offered via teleaudiology. In addition to providing world-class healthcare to United States veterans, the Mountain Home Veterans Affairs Medical Center is also home to one of the country's top centers in the area of audiology and vestibular balance research. Research is focused on improving the quality of life for veterans with hearing and balance disorders and developing clinical best practices for the assessment and rehabilitation of hearing and balance function in veterans and the community at large. Hearing loss and tinnitus are the most common service-connected disabilities in veterans, and dizziness and balance disturbances are common symptoms associated with blast exposure and mild traumatic brain injury. To prepare for VA clinic, the audiology department has 3 designated student workrooms. While serving veterans as a student at the Mountain Home VA, it is important to uphold the Mountain Home VA mission statement. Honor and serve America's veterans by providing exceptional health care that is patient-centered and preferred by veterans. Located on the Mountain Home campus is Building 60. It is a state-of-the-art, newly remodeled facility dedicated to preparing practice-ready health professionals in an innovative, interprofessional, experiential learning and research environment. The 2-year IP experience involves collaboration between medical, PT, SLP, nursing, pharmacy, and audiology, and includes activities with simulated patient encounters. Thank you for watching the James H. Quillen Department of Audiology virtual tour. We look forward to one day meeting you in person.
Good day. My name is Dr. Earl Johnson. I'm an audiologist here at the VA Medical Center at Mountain Home, and thanks for your interest in the program at East Tennessee State University, for which we are the VA Academic Affiliate. This means that I'll be teaching some of your coursework related to hearing aids. Those courses are titled Amplification Systems. And you'll also work with us quite a bit here at the VA in various hearing aid clinics for which I'll supervise. And I'll also work with you in our monthly case conference, which is a time in which we gather together to talk about recent clinical cases that either you've observed or that someone else has completed and that you have an interest in. As always, we welcome students who are interested in learning to become an audiologist and that will one day become licensed after graduating from the program. And so thank you for your interest in the program if you like what you see and hear in our orientation. Thank you.
Hi, I'm Nick Giuliani. I'm a research audiologist here at the VA. In the clinic, I really like to do hearing aids. Previously, I've done pediatrics and cochlear implants, but here mostly just focusing on the hearing aids. Last summer, I taught the AMP 2 class, which is the Advanced Hearing Aids course, and you take the summer after your first year. And then my research interests, so I've done, I've looked at listening effort, and I've used tools like pupillometry and skin conductance, so really looking at the autonomic nervous system. And then I've also done some research on how people hear who have different peripheral neuropathies, and the particular one that I researched was Charcot-Marie-Tooth neuropathy.
Hi, my name is Erin, and I graduated from ETSU in the AUD program. Now I work as a research audiologist at the VA, and I'm also very fortunate to be able to assist with several classes at ETSU and supervise students. I hope that you're enjoying your virtual tour, and I hope to meet you soon.
Maybe I should start with, again, reintroducing myself. So I'm Jacek Smorzyński. I'm a program coordinator for AUD program. As you probably already guessed by my accent and my first and last name, I'm not from here. I'm originally from Poland. My background was in electrical engineering, majoring in acoustics. I started working with music acoustics, noise control, then I switched more to auditory perception. That's when I got my PhD, and about 3 weeks after defending my PhD, I ended up in the Netherlands, in Eindhoven, working on auditory perception. And at that point, I thought of going back to Poland, but it turns out there was an open postdoc position at the University of Connecticut Health Center. So I went there, and that's what introduced me to audiology. I work very closely with fantastic audiologists with more than 25 years of experience. My first task when I went there was to design and kind of execute a lab system to measure ultra-acoustic emissions. So that's what actually brought me to audiology. I started also working in pediatric hospital, working with audiologists and SLP. Then I went back to Europe, to Switzerland. I was the director of research at the University Hospital in Basel, Switzerland. Worked again with doctors, medical students, residents. And then at that time, kind of by chance, I heard that there was a AUD program accredited in Johnson City. So I applied and left my interview with the offer. So I'm here for 17 years now. Because my way to reach the field of audiology was really, really curvy, I never got my clinical license. So I'm the only one among all the faculty that cannot supervise students in the clinic. I teach some foundation courses. So first years have me for the ANP course, Anatomy Physiology of the Auditory System. We have two first years. You can ask them how terrible, horrifying experience it is. In the first spring, I teach psychoacoustics. And then, as Dr. Fagelson mentioned, during the first summer, as you realize, we're working more like trimester system. So especially during the first and second year, students taking very heavy load of courses, didactic and clinic, during their summer trimesters. During the first trimester, with Dr. Fagelson, we teach Audeval 2 course. I teach the part related to autoacoustic emissions. I also teach a research class, so that's what brings me to this slide. In addition, I also am program coordinator, so trying to take care of several administrative parts of the program. One of them is actually to know what we have today, trying to recruit the best students we can have, and we're really proud of our students. I hope you all understand difference between AUD and PhD program. So AUD is a clinical doctorate degree, but we still think it is important for our students to understand the research and to be what we call, critical consumer of research. and understand how research can advance healthcare. And I always use my own example of starting archacoustic emission in a lab. And I tell students when we start talking about OAEs that it took me 10 minutes to get the very first distortion product archacoustic emission measurement on my own ear. Now you can do it with portable systems, and I'm working on a project together with a German company and with Missouri State AUD program on autoacoustic emissions, and we're using a portable system. You can collect about 2,000 data points within about 2 or 3 minutes. So, and again, a lot of those procedures and diagnostic tools that are available right now started with research. So I think that's important to understand that in addition to those benefits that are listed here on the slide. So each of us here at ETSU and the VA, we have our own research agenda. So we can pretty much cover every topic you can think about for the capstone project. So here are some general descriptions of those projects that students did together with the faculty. It's not a complete list. There are more and more topics that recently there are several very exciting surveys done, and so pretty much we can cover whatever, you know, the idea students might have, or the sometimes students go to the projects that are already run by the faculty. So again, we all have our own research agenda. We present, now traveling is stopped, so we cannot go to the meetings, but there are some of the meetings were and will be virtual. We try to publish as much as possible. And I think what's important here is that Bullard's saying that we incorporate our research in teaching. I try to do it in courses that I teach. Whatever new I find, even in A&P, there's still a lot of unknown about, you know, kind of molecular level, how the cochlea functions. So I try to incorporate those brand new discoveries published into the teaching, the same with autoacoustic emissions. We try as much as possible to get some research grants. Sometimes that's a possibility, even some small internal grants for the ETSU mechanisms. We might get some money to support students during the summer or pay for subjects or special software, whatever we need. So the student capstone project is required. It's not a dissertation, it's not a thesis, but it's pretty substantial project to be completed. So typically it starts during the second year. In addition to doing the project, students also take a sequence of research classes that I teach. So we split that as a one credit course over 3 trimesters. So I encourage students to talk to every faculty they think they would like to work with, kind of shop around and try to find if there are any project that students might join, or maybe sometimes students have their own ideas, and we have some students that came up with absolutely incredible ideas, and some of those projects were very successful and got some awards. So it is open discussion. But so the project, typically students start working on their projects during their second year, but the project needs to be completed by the end of the third spring before students going for the fourth year externship. We organize the Capstone Research Day. That's a day of celebrating research achievements of our students. That's typically done at the close to the end of April, beginning of May, again in the third year. That's also mandatory for the first and second year students. So sometimes that's a kind of inspirational event for those students thinking what they would like to do and say, oh, there was a project presented. It's exciting. Maybe I would like to continue that or get a kind of spin-off of that. In addition, we ask, we require our students to present at the local, state, or national meetings by graduation. Again, this year is a little different because some of those meetings were canceled, but hopefully we'll go back to that. Our students were very, very successful in completing outstanding projects, and when submitted for for presentations at different conferences at national level, they received their awards. So I just listed some of those. This is not a complete list. So we had students that received the research award at the annual convention of AAA. So if you don't know that, those are just five students that are selected to present orally their research. And Dr. Erin Dula, that you met virtually, she was one of them. And then also at ASHA and the American Auditory Society meeting, which is every February or March in Arizona. Again, the next one will be virtual. We have at ETSU, we have so-called Appalachian Student Research Forum. It's not an ETSU conference. It is a regional conference with hundreds of posters presented and some oral presentations. And our students very often receive the first or second awards. And they compete again with medical students, residents and biomedical students. So this is not an easy task to be awarded at that Appalachian Student Research Forum. So again, here's the list, and one of those that is at the bottom here, that was the student that again got the Student Research Award at AAA. Unfortunately, the meeting was canceled last minute due to COVID. I mean, later, if you have any question about the research, we can talk about it. I would like briefly cover some of the admission process. I know some of you already started your application. So here are the admission requirements. So one of them is the cumulative GPA of 3.25 on a full scale for the last 2 years of undergraduate studies or within the major. We had some students that had a kind of, you know, complicated transcripts. So it's not always within the major, but we're looking at those more advanced courses as part of the application, evaluation of the applications. We used to require GRE scores. Now we understand that it might be a little tricky to get the GRE test to be completed. So after our discussion among faculty and also the Dean of the School of Graduate Studies, we make it optional for the fall 2021 admissions. It doesn't mean we stop it forever. We hope that the testings will be, testing opportunities will go back. Actually, students can take a GRE test from any location. So it's actually even a little simpler if you think about, rather than traveling to the testing center, you can do it from your own home. So it is optional. If students already took GREs, we would like to have a look at the scores. If students decide not taking that, we look at the courses that are kind of reflective of their abilities related to not what normally would be reflected by the GREs. So there are some of the prereqs of the credit courses in lab sciences. We call it lab sciences. Doesn't mean that you have to have a lab component in the chemistry, biology, or physics. And you can mix that. So for example, could be all 8 credits in physics, or maybe 3 in biology, 3 in physics, 2 in chemistry. It doesn't matter. We think that kind of scientific background is important for our program. We also require 6 credits of college level maths. 3 of those must be in statistics. That doesn't mean all those prereqs have to be completed at the time of application. So if, for example, you're still planning to take 3 credits of statistics in the spring semester, it's fine. those requirements need to be met at the time of enrolling, which is in August. Here's a little statistics of admissions from last 6 years. We used to get between 60 and 80, and we had 1 year that we had over 90 applications. Last year, we had a lower number, and that probably partially related to different aspects. COVID already started at that time. So when we evaluate the applications, we take into account overall GPA, in major or last 2 years, or if a transcript is more complex, we look very carefully in all those high level courses. And then GRE, again, this year for next 2021 applications, it would be optional. So the application process is full online. If you go to the main website of ETSU or School of Graduate Studies, there is instruction how to do it. You can start at any point. Doesn't mean you start, you have to complete it immediately. You can start and put those components into the system as whenever you're ready, but the deadline is February 1st. So by February 1st at midnight, that system will close for you to add any components. There are still possibilities of adding maybe letters of recommendation, but then you have to request that through Shella Bennett, who is the program specialist at the grad school. So the application needs to include transcripts from all colleges, universities attended, GRE scores, if you decide to take it, then our school code is 1198. Again, this is optional for this current cycle of admission process. Three letters of recommendations, they have to be sent using the online application system. So you just provide the link to those, your professors or whoever, or clinical supervisors, whether you decide to ask to write the letter for you, and they got that link and they submit that letter directly to the online system. We also looking at the personal statement or essay, pretty much telling us why you think audiology is the career that you decide to proceed with. And then, it used to be optional, but we switched that. So CV is now required. And again, it's uploaded with the application. You can put the transcripts right now if you like, but sometimes we prefer to also look at your updated transcripts, including the full grades, because typically those are the courses that might be more related to your major, and you can always update those transcripts later. The new online application system that was put into action last year accepts now unofficial transcripts, so you don't have to put official transcripts when you start your application process. But students who are admitted to the program, they have to, by the end of the fall semester, submit official transcripts from all previously attended colleges and universities. If it's not done, then the student is dismissed by the School of Graduate Studies. But I think that new system has some advantage because, for example, we had students that took some courses, really late in the spring semester, or sometimes even during the summer. You can still upload those and then later provide official transcripts. So when the deadline is approached, and then at the beginning of February, we have access to those applications. There is an admission committee. I chair that group. We evaluate those applications, we discuss them, and we also then start ranking, and we make first decisions roughly around March 1st. I can't recall that it's not listed. I'm sorry about that. We also require an interview. So what we did for several years when we had the face-to-face open house, we used that opportunity to talk to students. And so what we will do again, and we switch in January and then February when COVID started, we did phone interviews, and then probably what we'll do, we'll probably do the Zoom interview. So once we start evaluating the applications, those of you who decide to apply, and I hope you all consider applying, then we'll contact you and schedule an interview. Then we send the first round of admission offers around March 1st. Remember one thing, I'm pretty sure those of you who will be applying for 2021 admissions, you will apply to different programs. We would love to see your application here, but of course you have many choices. Remember that according to the agreement of all programs that are accredited, AUD programs, the deadline to accept the admission is April 15. So you might receive several offers from different programs, but you have technically till April 15 to let all those programs know if you accept or decline that decision. We have some tuition scholarships available. Those are for first year students. I just got an email from the grad school about it. So I offered my participation in a kind of task force to look at maybe some new mechanisms for tuition scholarships. We'll see how that goes. So that is 8 hours a week. Each student receiving the tuition scholarship is assigned to the faculty and help with different type of activities. The tuition scholarship waives in-state and out-of-state tuition during the academic year, which means fall and spring semester. It waives also out-of-state tuition during the summer. Doesn't provide a stipend. There are, as you probably have that the same in your undergrad programs, there are different fees. So students have to pay all fees every trimester. Currently, that's approximately $1,750 per trimester. The other mechanism we have directly from our department available for students is a half graduate assistantship. Full graduate assistantship is 20 hours a week. Our first and second year students, they are really busy with didactic courses and clinics. So the grad school agreed to split those assistantships into half. So that's 10 hours a week. It could be related to the faculty, working with the faculty or in the clinics. Even though this is a half GE, it waives all out-of-state tuition during this fall, spring, and summer trimester, waives half of in-state tuition. Currently, the minimum stipend is $3,500 paid in 9 installments. But that doesn't waive in-state tuition during the summer. Again, students have to pay those fees. As Dr. Elangavan mentioned earlier, there are several opportunities across the campus in the library testing center, office of disability services, tutoring, pretty much everywhere. Our students are very, very successful in finding some of those opportunities, for even first year, some for the second and third year. And full GA is at 20 hours a week. It waives all in-state and out-of-state tuition during the academic year. Stipend is at least $7,000. One thing here is we had some students that had successfully had those full GAs during the third year, but students had to be kind of reminded, and they know about it. The clinical rotations is the highest priority. So if it's 20 hours a week, those assistantships, if some work could be done during the evenings or on weekends and remotely, that's probably more feasible than during regular business hours. We meaning our AUD program, we participate in so-called academic common market. I know we have several students this morning from Georgia. So that's a great news for you. Students from Georgia with residency in Georgia, South Carolina, and West Virginia, they pay in-state tuition on the basis of so-called academic common market. Residents of border counties pay in-state tuition. So in North Carolina, that's the list of those counties and four counties in Virginia. In addition, there are some scholarships provided by the School of Graduate Studies. There is no application needed. The system automatically targets those students who are eligible. So once the student accepts our offer of admission, then the system should automatically assign the student as being eligible for one of those three mechanisms. So there's no application needed. The bad news is that those scholarships cannot be combined with a tuition scholarship or graduate assistantship. One is for a so-called Carter Scholarship Plus, out-of-state students who are residents in Bancambi and Henderson counties that pay $17,000 per academic year. Those scholarships are automatically renewable if a student is eligible up to 9 semesters. The other is called Carter Scholarship. Those are for students who with residency within approximately less than 250 miles of ETSU. There's a list on the site of the scholarship office. Carter Scholarship pays $14,000 per academic year. For those out-of-state students, they reside beyond 250-mile radius of ETSU, that's $11,000 per academic year. We also have the mechanisms for international students. All right. So that's what we concluded our side. And I would like Rebecca, Julius, Becky, to share yours.
That's me. Hi. Okay. So just to introduce myself, my name is Becky Jurius. I am a third year student here at ETSU. I did my undergrad at Appalachian State over in Boone, North Carolina. I wear a couple of different hats in this program. I am going to talk to you today about the Student Academy of Audiology. I am the vice president of that organization. I also am the clinic GA. You heard my voiceover on the Nave videos. So I basically live in this department. So I am happy to answer any questions that you might have a little bit later. So just a little bit about SAA. We are kind of under the umbrella of the American Academy of Audiology. So this is just the national student organization. We focus on networking, we do advocacy, we do a lot of volunteering, we do fundraising as well. Due to COVID, we're having a little bit less of all of these things. We're still trying to kind of figure out what service opportunities are going to look like and what different volunteer opportunities we're going to have. We serve the community as best as we can. We start getting students involved in the field of audiology. I always like to say that networking starts as soon as you start your first year. You want to start making these connections because audiology is such a small field. You want to make connections that will most likely last the entirety of your career. So we work to give you hands-on experiences. I believe someone earlier mentioned the remote area medical clinic that I'll talk a little bit more about in a couple slides. That is one of my favorite things about this program is how much humanitarian work we're involved in. So having that just kind of opportunity to help the community as best as we can is really important to us here at ETSU. So like I said, we're involved with the remote area medical. We used to do Wise Virginia as well, but they actually have decided to move that clinic in the future. So we're not sure where that's going to be moved to, but I imagine if it's close enough that we will continue to be involved in that clinic as well. We are involved with the Tennessee Special Olympics. We do the hearing screenings at the Olympic Games in Gatlinburg, Tennessee. And there's also a basketball tournament that is held every year in Nashville that our students will go and actually stay overnight and do hearing screenings out there as well. Unfortunately, the basketball tournament was canceled because of COVID, but the event in Gatlinburg, we kind of squeaked that in right before everything kind of shut down. So both of those are absolutely amazing experiences, and I really enjoyed working it at the one in Gatlinburg. That's the only one that I've been to. We're also involved with the Buddy Run. That's a fundraiser here in Johnson City. I believe it's actually on ETSU's campus. We make signs to support the runners. We direct traffic. We do pretty much whatever the organizers of that event need to do. In the past, we have also done Ronald McDonald House meals. Unfortunately, due to COVID, it's not looking like that's going to be an opportunity for us this year, but we hope to be involved with that again in the future. But we have tried to reach out to them and unfortunately haven't really gotten any yes or no's on whether or not that's going to work out. So remote area medical, this basically provides free and reduced price healthcare to people who otherwise cannot afford it due to lack of insurance, due to lack of income, really anyone who would benefit from the remote area medical clinic, no one is turned away. The dentistry aspect of it, which you can see a picture of here on the top, is the biggest draw for this clinic, just because of dental insurance differences. And audiology, I'm not sure how many years off the top of my head we have been doing it. I know that we've done it every year since I've been here. We provide free hearing tests and reduced price hearing aids to people involved in the clinic. I believe we actually just had a planning meeting for this yesterday. So we are gearing up for that event, and I'm very much looking forward to helping out with that again. These are just some pictures from previous events. Up here in the top left, you've got the Buddy Run from, I believe that was 2 years ago. We have a group of us went to Gatlinburg for the healthy hearing screenings. I believe this was also my first year in the program. And this, both of these bottom pictures were taken at the Wise Virginia RAM clinic 2 years ago, I believe. So we need some more updated pictures, but we are very involved with RAM and Special Olympics especially. We also do fundraising. We help host the hooding ceremony, which is like our graduation kind of ceremony. Unfortunately, again, due to COVID, that looks very different. We're not sure kind of how the next couple of years are going to look hooding ceremony wise, but one of the things that students will do is raise funds for their hooding ceremony. So the Bristol Motor Speedway, we actually go and like direct traffic for that. Unfortunately, I feel like this whole presentation is me saying, unfortunately, due to COVID, that has also had a wrench thrown in that system. I believe they were offering it this year, but we have opted not to participate in it this year due to health concerns. We do a community fundraiser at Sweet Frog. It is a frozen yogurt place in Johnson City where they actually donate a portion of the proceeds to our program, and that's a portion of the proceeds for the entire day. They don't have to say like, hey, I'm here for ETSU Audiology. It's whatever they make that day, they will donate a portion of that to us. We do a bake sale where our students will bring in baked goods and sell them for $1 each over at the VA, and that is always a big hit over there. We do the cutest pet contest where you can enter your furry friends to the contest, and we will vote on who has the cutest pet in the program. I think Dr. Bramlett won with her chinchilla a couple years ago. We do a raffle basket auction. Again, I'm not quite sure if that's going to be a thing this year that we do, but we will definitely try. And this past summer, we actually started what we call the Flamingo Flush fundraiser, and that was a faculty-based fundraiser, I guess, for lack of a better term, where faculty members could pay. It turned out to be me and the president of SAA to drive to other faculty members' houses and flock their yard. So we ordered a bunch of plastic flamingos and put them in their yards. This is Dr. Bramlett with her flocked yard here. That was a lot of fun. We got a lot of great feedback from the community, just saying that it was kind of fun just to walk past the houses and be like, why do they have flamingos in their yard? Have those people lost their minds? So we got a lot of positive feedback for that. We're hoping to continue that into the next couple summers. So that's all I've got SAA-wise. I stopped sharing. Whoops. I do also have, I mentioned here careers a little bit earlier, and I do have that pulled up if I can figure out how to, there we go. So this is just kind of what that looks like. Like I said, it is run by Indeed, so it's just kind of a job search. You can see where it is, how late or how recently it was posted. They kind of give catchy titles, and you can see kind of where it is and what kind of practice it is, what their audiology staff looks like, and kind of what clinical opportunities they will give their students. So that is a really great resource for students who are looking for fourth years. I'm not gonna lie, I did peruse that quite a bit during my first and second years, just kind of dreaming of the future, and that did kind of help me get through the rougher times in the program. So again, if you have any questions a little bit later on, I am more than happy to answer as best as I can.
Thank you so much, Becky.
Thank you so much, Becky.